So good morning to all of you, respected Major General Bakshi, my good old friend Professor Kalyan Raman, Professor Chowdhury, and many very illustrious scholars in the field, ladies and gentlemen. Now I am extremely happy to be here for two reasons, that I am able to discuss with the research that we have been doing on the Saraswati and how we can take to the logical conclusion. That is very important. And secondly, I am requesting General Bakshi to take a lead in establishing a center for Saraswati studies. I think the government of India should do that and make sure that the research that we produce is of high quality, accepted by the scholarly world, and the information that this particular center will produce, now that should be included in the textbook, because even today the textbook do not discuss about beyond Harappan and Mohenjo-daro. People do not know about Rakhigarhi, Dholavira, Lothal, very important sites in India. That information, and we have done so much research, very scientific research on the archaeology of this region, but unfortunately that research is not really finding the place in the textbook. And naturally we are not really educating the people of the country, and therefore there is a lot of misunderstanding about the civilization, about the relevance of the civilization, etc. Now the stage has come, in fact. Now we have done a lot of research on the early civilization of the country. We have reconstructed the history of the early civilization. We know the history now. We know the town planning of the Harappans, the material culture of the Harappans. But we need to go beyond, in fact. Let me tell you, give you one example. I was excavating a site very close to Rakhigarhi, a small site called Karsola. And we had a special guest, in fact, in the form of former Prime Minister's daughter, Upinder Singh, who was the professor of Delhi University here. And with her, of course, being a daughter of the Prime Minister, with her there were a lot of IAS and IPS officers. And I was surprised, I was showing the remains to the students and Upinder Singh. And I was surprised to hear some comments, in fact, coming from these officials. Some say that, what a waste of the national wealth, why these people have come all the way from Pune and working in this, small village in Haryana. This is a waste of the national wealth. They are wasting their own time. Second comment was that maybe there is some wealth buried here. So people want to excavate that wealth. And that is the intention of this, of this team. And the last comment was very interesting. Somebody said that, these people did not get an opportunity to play in the dust when their children, they are playing now. So this is the level of understanding among the people, who are supposed to be the cream in the society. So still, we are not, and we take the blame, because, we have not taken the subject to these people. We are not made aware about the importance of the subject. So that needs to be done, in fact, because people should really understand the significance, importance of the Indian heritage, which is so important. Secondly, we are connected, in fact. We are not really disconnected like the Europe or America. We have very strong roots, in fact. We identify our roots, in fact, in the 5,000-year-old civilization. Particularly at Rakhigarhi, on one side, we have, modern habitation, 10,000 people living on the site. On the other side, we have the 5,000-year-old civilization. And these people, they connect themselves to the ancient civilization. So we are not really detached from that. And that is very important, that perhaps India is one of the few countries, perhaps China and India, where we have very long history, in fact. The roots are going back to 5,000, 6,000, and now almost 9,000 years. So we need to really, you know, preserve this particular tradition. Thirdly, you know, there are a lot of, you know, basic knowledge, basic science, basic, you know, technology. Now that was introduced, you know, 5,000, you know, 6,000 years ago, and perfected by the Harappans, in fact, by maybe 5,000 years ago. And a lot of that, you know, continues on today. And we know that there are a lot of people who are still dependent on that, on this particular, you know, the what we call as the Indian knowledge system. So that is so relevant, in fact, you know, the knowledge that we are generating, that should, you know, reach to these people. And we try to make their life better, in fact, by providing the knowledge of the technology used by the ancient people, which was much higher than, you know, better than the technology used by the present craftsmen. And lastly, you know, how this knowledge that we are generating, how it is relevant today. You know, one example, just I'll give you that, and then I will, you know, end my introductory part, that the Harappans had developed such a unique water harvesting and water management system, perhaps unique in the world, and still it is unique, in fact. I don't really find parallel to that. If that, you know, that is found, in fact, at the site of Dholavira. Dholavira was established, in fact, in the desert part. And, you know, people, Harappans were aware that there is a dearth of water here, but they made the arrangement there, very excellent arrangement. If you can, you know, apply that method, Harappan method today, because today, you know, the nearest town is 110 kilometers, Rapur, and between Rapur and Dholavira, there are hardly, you know, 5 or 6 villages, and people are not establishing settlement there, mainly because of the dearth of water. But if you can apply this Harappan method, in fact, the simple indigenous, you know, method, the entire Kutch will be a green land. So this is the relevance, in fact. Now I'm just giving you an example that this is the relevance of the ancient civilization and how we can make use of that, how we can put the ancient, you know, knowledge and, you know, knowledge system to the use. That is very important. Now coming to the, you know, this particular session, I'm extremely happy that now we have two more very renowned archaeologists speaking about the discoveries made in this region. Dr. Sanjay Manjul, recently he has been, you know, promoted to the Joint Director General of the Archaeological Survey of India, and shortly he is going to take up this position, in fact, in the, you know, Archaeological Survey of India. But presently he is heading the Institute of Archaeology, which trains archaeologists for the service of the Archaeological Survey of India, basically. So this is, and he has conducted, you know, very important work, you know, very important excavation at two places, in fact. One is the Sanoli, which is, you know, a very, very important site, because for the first time, you know, we have discovered the chariot impact, which needs to be really properly highlighted. And the significance of this discovery needs to be brought to the entire world. Coming to the Saraswati Basin, General Bakshi has rightly mentioned that, you know, there were so many sites, in fact, in the Saraswati Basin. In 1965, one of our students, a lady student, she conducted the fieldwork, in fact, in a very difficult, you know, terrain of the country, in fact, in the desert part of the country, in Bikaner and Jaisalmer area, in that part. And she had discovered nearly 450 sites, Harappan sites, they were recorded. And in 2006, again, you know, I wanted to, you know, take the, you know, lead and, you know, take the trail of these, you know, sites that she had discovered. I wanted to document them properly and, you know, make a proper documentation of that. But to my surprise, I noticed that there are only maybe hardly 1 dozen sites left today. And all the other sites, such an important source of the country, now they have been destroyed completely. They have been leveled by the farmers and converted the site or the mounds into agriculture, flat agriculture fields. So we have to really make sure that, you know, whatever is left today at least, that should be at least protected, and protected for the posterity, because that's really important. And that is the reason, you know, I went back to the, you know, Saraswati Basin and started the, you know, the work at the, you know, very important sites. Secondly, you know, I took the challenge, in fact. The Archaeological Survey of India excavated the site of Birana, a very, very important site. And that site produced very early dates, going back to 6,500 BC for the beginning of the Harappan culture. But most of the scholars, including Indian scholars, they were not ready to accept the dates. Completely, you know, I don't know why they were not. Most of the scholars had accepted the dates from the site of, you know, site of Mehergarh when it was excavated, because that site was excavated by a French scholar, and we had no problems in accepting the dates provided by the foreigners. But these dates were provided by the Indian scholars, and there were a lot of doubts and raised. Some say that maybe the dates are contaminated, so the dates are not right. Some say that maybe, you know, the excavation method that, you know, Indians are following is not maybe scientific. So these are the comments, not ready to accept. And, you know, what the other comment was that maybe there's only one site from where, you know, we have the dates. We should have dates from different sites. And that is the reason, you know, I undertook the excavations at Girawad, which is a very, very important early Harappan sites in that region. The main aim was to understand the history and get the dates. Chronology of these sites is very important. So we did, you know, I did that. Then I went to the site of Mitathal. We have number of dates from that site, and also from site of Harmana. And then, of course, I came to the site of Rakhigarhi. And all these three sites, Girawad, Mitathal, and Harmana, they also have provided number of dates, series of dates now, which are going back to 5,500 BC. And there are a few dates, you know, which are 6,000 BC. So at this stage, you know, I'm putting this, you know, the beginning of the Harappan culture in this region, in the Saraswati region, to at least 5,500 BC. We need more dates, of course. I'm doing that, in fact, at the site of Rakhigarhi. So now people have to believe in it. We have scientific data. They cannot, you know, deny this particular, you know, data that we have generated. Secondly, I went to the site of Rakhigarhi in 2010-11. I used to visit, in fact, you know, every time, you know, whenever I was excavating at Harmana, I used to visit that site every year. And every time I used to go with my students, I could see that, you know, there's more encroachment on the site. There is more damage to the site. So I realized that, you know, that's one day this is the most important Harappan site in the country. And one day this is a very important treasure, cultural treasure of the country will vanish. And therefore I decided to undertake excavation in fact at the site of Rakhigarhi. But let me tell you that, you know, when I went there, it was not easy in fact. The local people say that we will not allow you to conduct the excavation here because the village does not get anything from this particular work. So why should we allow? Secondly, a lot of our land will be, you know, will be taken over by the government and we will not get compensation. But then I did not leave there in fact. They said that, no, you have lunch with us and go back. We will not allow you to conduct the work. But then, you know, I persisted in fact. I kept talking to the people. This is very important that why I'm telling, because, you know, this is how, you know, we have to, you know, practice in future also. I said that, you know, we have come all the way from Pune here and our intention is different. I said that, you know that, you know, your village has a great history and that great history needs to be brought to the notice of the entire world, not only the country. And I also said that, you know, your village has contributed immensely to the history of the country and to the history of the world. I said that, don't you want to know the entire world that, you know, this is the important village in the country? And slowly, slowly they realize that, you know, that this, our village is so important. And they said that, okay, we will allow you to do some limited work. And later they realize that, you know, this is a very, very important work that is happening in part of the village. And now they say that, you know, they are inviting, but they say that, come and do this more work. We are there to help you. So that is very important, that what we call as community archaeology or public archaeology is a very important part of the, you know, of this whole exercise. And then, you know, people realize that, you know, this is a very important site in the country and this needs to be saved. Even though it is a part of the, you know, Archaeological Survey of India, it is protected by the Archaeological Survey of India, but because of the, you know, lack of maybe sufficient manpower, they are not able to protect the site properly. And I realized that, you know, unless there is a, you know, participation of the local people in the preservation and protection of the heritage, it is not going to happen. So, you know, then I, you know, tried, you know, I tried to educate the people, right? I met Dr. Beast, please come on the stage. He's so give big applause to Professor R.S. Beast. So all of you know, of course, you know, Dr. R.S. Beast has excavated many Harappan sites. And the iconic one, of course, is the site of Dholavira, which was excavated by, you know, under his direction by the Archaeological Survey of India. So these two scholars, you know, stalwarts, are going to speak about, you know, the discovery that they have made. So coming back to the, you know, this public archaeology at the site of Rakhigarhi, then, you know, people got to know, in fact, you know, that this work is going to be useful for them, not only from the point of view of knowledge, but also from point of view of, you know, maybe material culture also. There will be more jobs, in fact, in the village because of the development of the site. And now, in fact, you know, that our efforts have borne fruit, in fact. They have discovered that, you know, that it is our responsibility to protect the site. So they have formed a group now in the village. And that group is making sure that, you know, there is no, you know, unauthorized digging on the site. The site is being protected. So this is the reason that, you know, that you know, people are aware about the importance of the heritage and they are coming forward. This is the type of efforts that needs to be done, in fact, in this part. So the work that, you know, we have done, in fact, in the Saraswati Basin. Now there is no doubt about the identification of the Saraswati River. You know, multidisciplinary approaches conducted have already established the presence of Saraswati. The only, you know, information that we do not have is when the river Saraswati has disappeared. Because, you know, we have tried, you know, very hard, in fact, to find out this particular event. The geologists have tried. But so far there is no positive result. But let me tell you that, you know, the archaeology can give you some hint, in fact, about when the river has gone dry. Because, you know, when we conducted the work, in fact, there, now this is, I'll just come back to the site. This is the area of the Harappan civilization, a very, very large area occupied by the Harappans. In the contemporary world, this was a sort of empire. But let me make some, you know, two very important statements before I actually start my presentation. One is that, you know, this, I talk about the empire. The concept of nation, in fact, was started by the Harappans. Because, you know, in the early Harappan stage, there were a number of regional cultures. And they were integrated, in fact, at one stage, you know, by 2500 BC. And they created this, you know, this huge area, in fact, you know, which is quite, you know, which has got a, you know, a uniform culture. And this particular, you know, the integration was achieved by peaceful means. We do not have any evidence of the violence, in fact. And perhaps, you know, when it comes to the empire, we always, you know, have the impression that the empires are created by forceful means, because, you know, we thought that, you know, empires, the concept of empire starts from the Mauryan period. But actually, you know, this is the concept of the nation or the empire that, you know, we can see, in fact, during the Harappan times. So that is one, you know, very, you know, important, you know, statement that I wanted to make. Secondly, you know, I always believe that the Harappans are the founders of the Indian culture and tradition. Because from there in Patnobia, there is a lot of continuity. We are not really forgotten the, you know, Harappan tradition. And I have experienced that in fact, you know, in Haryana. When, you know, after the excavation, we used to move around in the village of Rakhigarhi, I used to get impression that I'm moving in fact in the Harappan village. Exactly the plan of the village is like Harappan, you know, plan. The house structure is exactly a copy of the Harappan structure. And, you know, most of the material used by the people is not different from the Harappans. Even the earthen pots, exactly similar. If you keep, you know, one modern earthen pot and the Harappan pot side by side, perhaps you will not be able to identify which one is Harappan and which is modern. The food habit of the people is same. Now, chicken tandoor was the contribution of the Harappans, and it is so popular in fact in that region. So there is a lot of continuity from the Harappan times. And that continuity and that particular tradition has spread almost all over the country and influence in fact. So I believe that, you know, the Harappans are the founders in fact of the Indian tradition and culture. And lastly, you know, Dr. Beast has already, you know, written about the relation between the Vedic people and the, you know, the, you know, Saraswati River. And I strongly believe that the Harappans are the Vedic people. And that is based on the data that, you know, we have generated from this particular region. We have the evidence of the beginning of the culture, and then, you know, that culture has gradually evolved and transformed into civilization at one stage. And we have scanned the whole area, and we do not have settlements in that number of the earlier period nor of the later period. And if the Vedic text has talked about the river Saraswati and the culture along the river Saraswati, it is, they have, the text has talked only about the Harappans. And we have, you know, very strong evidence for that. And Dr. Bis and, you know, Professor B.B. Lal, they have also mentioned, but, you know, what are the other criteria by which we can identify the Vedic people with the Harappans and the Saraswati. So this is a, you know, there is no doubt about, you know, the relation between the Vedic people and the Harappans and the Saraswati region. Now, I'm not going to spend much time because Professor Chaudhary and others are going to speak about the, you know, river Saraswati. But, you know, the, you know, satellite imagery, you know, the processing done by the scientists, by ISRO scientists, and, you know, the geologists, they have almost established now that, you know, the river Saraswati was existing and how it was flowing, in fact, from the foothills of the Himalayas, and it was how it was traveling in India, in Pakistan, and coming back, you know, coming down into the Gulf of Cambodia, you know, Kutch region. And, you know, this is the, you know, the trail of that very, you know, scientifically. The main river here, which is identified, you know, with modern Ghaggar and Hakra, and the major river, you know, the tributary, which is the Chautang today, which was called as the, you know, Drishyadwati River. And, you know, we have noticed that, you know, there are a large number of sites here. And what is interesting that, you know, I was talking to you that, you know, we can use archaeological data for identifying the event of the disappearance of the river. So when we studied the settlement pattern of the Harappans, we have noticed that, you know, there are sites of the mature early Harappan and mature Harappan located along the river banks, in fact, in on major river and also on the tributary. And after 2000 BC, the settlements are going away from the river bank. So that is very important event, but very important, you know, indication that perhaps river is becoming insignificant. Maybe it has started maybe disappearing or drying up, and therefore people are moving away from the river bank. So this is a very important, you know, data that we have, the archaeological data, which can give some hint about the disappearance of the river. So far, the scientific data that we have has not generated this type of, you know, dating for the event. So this is, you know, very important data that, you know, we have generated. Yeah, this is the, you know, it was not that only there is only one river, but there was a network of the rivers in fact. And no wonder that, you know, we find such a heavy concentration of the Harappan sites in this region. Out of, you know, total number of sites, nearly two-thirds of the sites are located in the Saraswati Basin and not in the Indus Basin. You can see some of the location of some of the important sites. The site of Banavali was excavated by Dr. R.H. Beast. Kalibanga, of course, is a very important site, Professor B.B. Lal. And it is here, in fact, you know, he found evidence of the fire worship and, you know, some evidence, you know, data, in fact, you know, which could be connected with the Rigvedic texts and the Vedic people. The large number of sites you can see here. And again, I know why I said that, you know, the Saraswati was the main attraction for the Harappans. Two reasons, of course. One is, you know, very, the basin is well watered, safe, in fact, compared to the Indus River basin. The main river is not as ferocious as the Indus River. And it has got a very rich tributary zone. And second, you know, it has got really, you know, very, very rich, you know, agricultural field. One of the, you know, maybe most fertile units, in fact, in the world. And it is here that, you know, we, no wonder that, you know, we can see the emergence, origin, development of the early cultures of the country. A very, very, you know, fertile region. Now, in last maybe 20 years, in fact, there is a lot of research happening in the Saraswati Basin. And initially, in fact, the government of India had a special, you know, focus on this particular river basin. And we have, you know, we have excavated so many sites. Being archaeologists, now I'm going to talk only about the archaeological data. And a number of these sites, in fact, you can see, in fact, here, that, you know, a number of sites, look, you know, in the Saraswati Basin have been excavated. And we have very strong data now. Nobody can deny, you know, the presence of the archaeological data. And that data has enabled us, in fact, to interpret some of the mysteries of the Harappan culture. Number of excavations conducted here have again established the chronology. The early phase is going back to almost 6,000, 5,500 BC. And we have now a series of dates. And this is again based on the actual data that we have generated. And what is important that, you know, I said that, you know, that this region has the evidence of the origin of the Harappan culture and the gradual development. And there are three sites, you know, where we have this strong evidence. One is the site of Birana, which has provided, you know, very strong data. We always talk that, you know, there is a transition from the early Harappan to the mature Harappan phase. But we have not demonstrated, you know, by scientific data, archaeological data, how that transition, how the transformation has taken place. But now, you know, we have shown that impact. And you can, particularly in the structures and pottery, that transition is very, very strong, very clear. And at these three sites, Birana, then Kunal, and Giravad, at these three sites, we have very, you know, strong evidence about the beginning of the Harappan culture, which is very modest. In fact, people have built, you know, very small circular structures. And then, of course, you know, there is a transformation, which I can show, in fact, with the help of the data. This is the evidence, you know, this is the actual data from the site of Birana. And here also, there is a very strong evidence about the, you know, beginning and gradual growth of the Harappan culture. This type of pits, in fact, have been found. You know, one family, in fact, own maybe three or four pits, and that form a cluster. And we have noticed that, you know, the function of each cluster was different. In fact, one or two were used for dwelling purpose, one for storage purpose, one for cooking purpose, like that. And these are the, so this is the kind of, you know, beginning that we notice, in fact, in the Harappan period. It is not that, you know, the town planning or the cities have come, you know, suddenly. There's a long precedence for that. And this begins, in fact, around, you know, 6000 BC, and then gradually evolves up to 2500 BC, and then there is a transformation. So this is a very important evidence, you know, we have been mentioning. And they are pit dwellings because, you know, in some of them, we actually find the fireplace and, you know, the evidence of the dwelling. Then in the next stage, of course, you know, the people have started building structures over ground. And there is, you know, in the early stage, of course, we find these type of, you know, rectangular or squarish structures. And then, you know, they have also produced the building material in the form of the, you know, bricks. They have used both, in fact, the mud bricks and the burnt bricks also. And particularly the burnt bricks here, you can see, they were used in the toilet or the bathroom. And also you can see that, you know, they have begun the typical, the concept of tandoor, you know, which continues on today. And this is the earliest evidence of that, in fact, coming from the site of Parmana, dated to 3200 BC. So this concept begins, in fact. In the next stage, of course, now overground structures, then we find small structures. And in the third stage, of course, now they become, you know, the size become, you know, bigger and bigger. And then in the last stage, of course, now this type of planning, in fact, comes into existence. A very well planned, in fact. You can see here, you know, we can see a street here, a lane, you know, maybe small street or lane. And then you can see the planning, modicum of planning, perfect planning, in fact, comes into existence. So there's a gradual growth, you know, in this particular activity. And this is very important that, you know, there's an origin of the culture here, and there's a growth of the culture. At no stage, those who propound the theory of, you know, Aryan migration or the Aryan invasion, they should show us, in fact, you know, what is the evidence they, you know, they talk about. But we can show that, you know, that there's a contrary evidence which proves that, you know, it is the local development, indigenous development, which was happening throughout the period of the Harappan culture. And we are ready, in fact, for this argument, in fact. Those who want to, you know, come and discuss about that, we are ready for that now, because for last many years, in fact, now we have been generating data, scientific data, and now we are ready, in fact, you know, for the discussion on this particular issue. Not only the archaeological data, of course, we have generated this, you know, the genetic data also, and that data will be published very soon, and very soon people will come to know about the early people of the Indian culture. You can see the evidence, actually, you know, the data that has been excavated. So this is how there's a growth impact of the culture. And we get, you know, very good evidence about the, you know, the activities carried out in different complexes. This is one of the kitchens of the, you know, Harappans. This is the data coming from the site of Parmana, which was excavated on a very large scale. And then, of course, similar evidence is found, in fact, in the pottery also. You know, we can see, in fact, this is kind of pottery which was introduced in the early stage from the site of Birana, also from Girawad. And the early pottery is, you know, handmade, crude, you know, not properly, you know, finished. So this is the beginning of the, you know, Harappan tradition, Harappan pottery. And then, of course, you know, the pottery becomes, you know, these are the different varieties of the pottery. But gradually, in fact, you know, in the ascending order, you know, the pottery becomes quite refined. And, you know, we can see the transformation of the pottery, which is crude and handmade, becomes a classical Harappan pottery at one stage. So this is, you know, the pottery from different stages transforming into the Harappan. We also have found a large number of burials. In fact, we know the burial custom of the Harappans in this region. Slight variation, in fact, when you compare the burials from this region with, you know, burials from maybe Harappa, you can see some slight maybe variation, in fact, maybe little variation, in fact, in the direction, and also slight variation, in fact, in the placing of the burial pots. But more or less, you know, they have followed the same tradition, in fact. And we have discovered a large number of burials at the site of Parmana. We excavated. Parmana was excavated the particular cemetery was excavated on a very large scale. And one of our intention was, of course, to extract DNA from this, because unless you have DNA, perhaps you will not be able to talk about the people, the composition of the population, and their relation with the contemporary population, and the continuity. So that data now, of course, we have. But here in Patna, we miserably failed. In fact, we did not get any data, DNA data, from the burials. Even though we excavated nearly 70 burials, we did not get any evidence from this. And that is mainly because of our method. In fact, we excavated all the burials, 70 burials at a time. We kept them open for long because we wanted the people to come and see them. And in that process, in fact, they were open. They were, there were a lot of rain and sunlight, which affected the presence of the DNA. Perhaps it slipped away. And later, of course, we realized, of course, our mistake. And then we corrected that mistake, in fact, at the site of Rakhigarhi. And I will show, in fact, what measures, in fact, we have taken, in fact, at the site of Rakhigarhi. So these are the different kinds of burials. One is the primary burial, where the dead body was placed immediately after the death. These are some of the primary burials. You can see some of the burial goods also. We find pots which contain food and water, in fact. We have analyzed the pots from the site of, from the burials of Farmana. And one, we found, of course, the traces of the food. But one very interesting evidence that we came across, the evidence of Indian curry. And the antiquity of Indian curry goes back to the Harappan times. In some of the pots, you find ginger, turmeric, and traces of the brinjal also. And that is very important. But I always believe that the Harappans are the owners or the authors of the Indian curry. And then from there, it continues. Then the second kind of burials we get are the symbolic burials, in which, of course, the dead body was kept open for some time, maybe somewhere outside, like the Parsis do today. And they collected some bones, and then bones were buried in a pit, along with the maybe burial goods like pots, ornaments sometimes, and the tools. And the third one, of course, is a symbolic burial. We have burial pit, we have burial goods, but no trace of any human burial bones at all. So probably the person died somewhere, his body could not be retrieved, but they thought of giving ceremonial burial to the person, and that is how we have the symbolic burials like this. Then I come to the site of Rakhigarhi, a very, very important site. And of course, this is a map prepared by the Archaeological of India when they were excavating between 1997 and 2000. And they had identified seven different mounds at the site. We have discovered two more mounds. Now there are now nine mounds. And there was a lot of, when we came here, in fact, there was a lot of controversy about the total area of the site, how big the site is. Different estimates were given. Even Dr. Beister also gave an estimate. So some say that it is 60 hectares, some say that it is 80 hectares, some say that maybe it is more than 200 hectares. But we have very no knowledge about the total area of the site. And no efforts, in fact, were made, in fact, to, find out, to measure the total area. So what we did, in fact, when I went to the site of Rakhigarhi, I just wanted to, find out this first, the total area of the site. We did not start the excavation immediately. We did that first. And we used the most scientific methods, in fact, the GPS survey, then, this total station survey, etc. And there are a lot of parts of the site which are destroyed by the people. And they're under the modern deposit. So the deposit was not visible. But fortunately, we had a number of whales, in fact, on the periphery of the site. So we observed the whales, and we could detect, the Harappan deposit, And now the total area that we have calculated is coming to around 550 hectares, quite extensive. But still, we are not excited about that because we want to establish whether the 550 hectare was occupied at one and the same time or it was gradually occupied. That needs to be established. We did, survey of the drone survey of the site. And here you can see, the modern village is occupying the major chunk of the site. It is under this modern occupation that we have the important part of the site. And only small portion of the site, not still, there is almost 50 hectare site which is still available for large scale work and research. But this is a part of the site which is still intact. These are the parts, this part also. And perhaps the main mound, mound number four, which is probably the citadel mound, that is under occupation. And also major part of the lower town is also. But you can see now, whatever is left in fact, the site is so, you know, well preserved. Not a scratch on this mound number two. Also, the no more views. Now, why Rakhigarhi in fact? I mentioned that, such an important site. But then, of course, we went there, with some research problems. And, three important problems I would like to mention. We are not intending to excavate the site on large scale, like maybe Mohenjo-daro or Harappa, because we know that, we will not be able to, maintain the, or protect the site after the excavation. And there's no need, in fact, to excavate the same kind of evidence, because, we are maybe going to repeat the same kind of archaeological data, same kind of pottery data. So our excavation was targeted, in fact. We just wanted, we went there with some problems, research problems, and it was targeted excavation. One important, issue that we wanted to deal with is the chronological issue, the beginning of the Harappan culture. We wanted to establish that also here. And the transition, in fact, from early Harappan to the mature Harappan, how that journey has happened. So that is one important issue that we wanted to tackle. Secondly, of course, our main intention was to extract DNA from the skeletal remains, so excavate some parts of the burials and get DNA so that we can undertake further research on that. And thirdly, that we want the site is being excavated with the in collaboration with the with the state government. So we wanted to develop the site from tourism point of view. And we have two plans under this. One is that excavate maybe limited part of the city, not bigger part. And then of course, that preserve that, protect that, so that people can go anytime and they can get the feel of the Harappan, maybe street, Harappan structures. So that is important plan we have. And at the same time, we have to have maybe research center and the museum there, where the data can be kept, so scholars can go there and study. And the museum can attract maybe the tourists. So this is a plan that we have. And this is the methodology that we adopted. We did not really go for the last excavation. And then we also thought that people, there needs to be done something for the people also. So we have some programs, in fact, community development programs as a part of this research project. I did, in fact, a lot of persuasion, in fact, in the initial stage. And, that has paid rich, dividend, in fact, now. And people are happy that, the work is happening. So, as I say that, initially we started the systematic survey of the site. So we did undertake this, total station survey. And we have prepared this, 3D maps of the site. The red portion shows the presence of the site or the visibility of the site. And the gray portion shows the, area that is under the modern occupation. And also we did the, this ground penetration radar survey at the site. We scanned the whole, whole site. And now we also had set up a, working station in fact on the site. And this data is very, very important. This method is so important. This is a non-destructive method. You don't need a lot of funding for this. You don't need a lot of, maybe big team for this. But at the same time, by using this particular method, you can try to identify maybe different activity areas of the, at the site. Maybe what are the important maybe, evidence likely to be found at the site. And, the total station in fact sends, this laser beam up to the depth of 20 meters. So you can try to find out if there are some, archaeological remains in the form of maybe structures or features that will be detected. We may not be identified, we will not be able to identify the function of the structure or the feature, but at least we know that there is something there in fact. So that is what we did in fact in the initial stage. And then of course, our data has, we have analyzed the data and we have been able to identify different, activity areas with the help of this, and plus the total site, area of the site. The two mounds that we had discovered. And then next impact, what we did, before the excavation, because ours was targeted excavation and we wanted to find out the evidence of the craft manufacturing. That was one of our issues also. So where exactly, over such a large area, where exactly the activities was performed. So what we did, in fact, we did this, the sampling, survey, in fact. We collected data from the site, and then, of course, we analyzed, and we could identify, the different activity areas. You can see, in fact, here, we could identify the activity of manufacturing of, pottery, manufacturing of maybe metal objects, manufacturing of the shelf, these terracotta bangles, even, these fiance, etc. So these are the cluster that we. And then, of course, we undertook the excavation, firstly to identify or, to reconstruct the complete history of the site. And this was our main trench. You can see that it has got nearly 23-meter deposit, the highest, thickest deposit at any Harappan site. And then, of course, we took, these are some of the early Harappan structures. We did a lot of research on the early Harappan. But this is very important that, we, on one mound, mound number two, we had hypothesized on the basis of the surface studies, surface indication that the activities, craft activities were carried out on mound number two. And we wanted to confirm whatever hypothesis we had made on the basis of that, whether that hypothesis is true or not. And we did find, in fact, a lot of, you can see the platforms, working platforms. And this is evidence of the manufacturing activity. We have found platforms, furnaces on the platforms. And what is interesting that we have this at different levels. Very interesting, because that shows the hereditary succession of the craft activity in the Harappan levels, carried forward from generation to generation. And this is very important evidence that we have. This is part of the granary that we excavated. And then, of course, the main intention, of course, main research was in the cemetery. This is a part of the cemetery that. Now, what we did, in fact, before the excavation, we had a very thorough discussion with the Korean scientists. We developed a research program with them. The Seoul National University has a very fine forensic science department. And some of the scientists from that department are working on ancient DNA. So we came in contact, and they suggested that the methodology needs to be slightly changed, modified. Firstly, they said that you have to take proper precaution, that use this precaution when you are excavating the burials, so that there is no contamination of the modern DNA impact in the ancient samples. And secondly, they say that you excavate one by one burial, document that properly, and then collect the samples and send it to the laboratory. So this is what we did, and then therefore we have found the strong indication of the ancient DNA from the Harappan remains. So the work was conducted by using this precaution, and now we know that there is no contamination impact in the ancient samples. Secondly, our other aim was to reconstruct the facial features of the Harappans, how the Harappans were looking like. And that, that research is happening in fact collaboration with the Korean scientists. And we have completed that research, and we have already submitted a paper for publication. I'm not going to give you the details unless the paper is published. But the Harappans were not different. The modern people are not different from the Harappans. They look like Harappans only. So this is the second research. And for that, of course, we need this type of data, in fact, complete skeletal remains. That is really important for the reconstruction of the facial features. And we have, fortunately, we have five such individuals, where we have undertaken this research. Then this is a very important, burial. There was a big article on the, the couple burial. Why we call them as couple? Because, this was given, one is male and one is female. There is no injury marks on body. But we call them as couple because, they are buried within the common cemetery. And they were buried with all complete honor. Had they had some kind of maybe illicit relationship, they would not have been given this type of treatment. Therefore, I believe that the concept of family maybe started from the Harappan times. Some more burials. This is very important, but today, we go you know, we place a dead body on the pyre and we go around and break pots. So this is the evidence, you know, we have around the burials, you know, we have this type of evidence. So probably that concept again, that tradition started by the Harappans. I did, you know, very extensive samples. We took all the precaution while doing the sampling also. And this is how, you know, we did, you know, we proceeded with the scientific research on these skeletal remains. We did, you know, the anthropological examination completed. We have published. We have done the CT scanning, which is really required for the reconstruction. That data is required for the reconstruction of the facial features. So we have done that. Then we also have done the, you know, the craniofacial reconstruction, the 3D reconstruction of the, you know, Harappan people. Then we have done the paleo, you know, parasitology. This is very important. The new field developed by the Korean scientists. In case you do not get DNA in the bones, then there is a likelihood that, you know, that the DNA is present in fact in the parasite eggs, and every human body in fact, in our body also, there are parasite eggs because of the maybe contaminated water, etc. And when the dead body is buried, the parasite eggs remain. Maybe other things disappear, but the parasite eggs remain. And sometimes they contain even DNA of the person. So the Koreans have done scientific impact research on that. And we have also, we are doing research on that also. So far, of course, there is no success, but you know, we are trying our best. And of course, you know, we are doing this. Now, finally, of course, you know, the stable isotope will give us some idea about the kind of food these people were eating, the food habit, the percentage of maybe plant food, animal food, everything in fact can be found out. Also, we can find out the, you know, the pathology of that period, and also the ancient DNA. Pathology, the Koreans are working on that. And after the end of the study, they were very disappointed. They said that, you know, Harappans were so healthy, and that is but natural because the town planning that the Harappans had, you know, had built in fact, and the precaution that they had taken, the type of maybe the drainage system that they had adopted was so impeccable. With today, in fact, the government of India has to initiate programs like Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. But that Abhiyan was started by the Harappans long back. We have forgotten, maybe we were made to forget about that. But this is in our genes, in fact, so we should, you know, keep that in mind also. So we did this also, very scientific research. And then lastly, you know, how the site can be preserved. Because there's a major challenge. The most of the structures at the site, they are made of only mud bricks. Not only at this site, but everywhere. And we know that, you know, in India, even in the world also, there are very few specialists, you know, who can really help us in, you know, preservation of that. So one way, in fact, of preserving the part of the settlement for the public is that, you know, we can raise these type of domes on the site. But certainly, you know, the site needs to be protected and preserved. And certainly, you know, it will be huge attraction. Why? Let me tell you just before I end my... The why people are not really studying the Harappan culture. Today, in fact, you know, there are hardly, you know, most of the Harappan archaeologists are sitting here only. Hardly 6 or 7, you know, Harappan archaeologists are working. In Egypt, you know, how many archaeologists are working? More than 300 archaeologists are working in Egypt on the Egyptian civilization. And they have produced more than 300 books. We are not really able to produce even half a dozen books on the Harappan civilization. Even public are not really, you know, they don't want to visit Harappan sites. They are not really aware about the Harappan sites. They want to visit, maybe, you know, given a choice, they would like to, you know, visit some maybe Egyptian site because there are pyramids to see there. But, you know, we also need to think about how we can attract the tourists. And what we are planning, in fact, at the site of Rakhigarhi is that, you know, we want to highlight the philosophy of the Harappans, which is completely different. The entire world would like to know the philosophy of the Harappans. One thing is clear that the Harappans were so competent. You know, they could have certainly created, you know, monuments like pyramids had they decided to do that. Because technologically, they were so sound, they were considered the best civil engineers in fact in the world. They could have done that. They have not done that intentionally because they thought that, you know, because they had a completely different system. They did not have this monarchical system. Probably some kind of panchayat system, some kind of democratic system they had. And you know, they thought that, you know, these type of monuments are of no use to the common people. They were generating so much wealth from the waste. They were looting the waste at that time. And that wealth was used by the Harappans for the welfare of the common people. They created those beautiful cities, very clean and hygienic cities, very well-planned cities for the common people. So that was the, you know, philosophy of the Harappans. They were more practical. They did not believe in burying a lot of wealth in the, you know, along with the dead bodies. They did that, of course, you know, symbolically. Because they knew that, you know, once it is done, it is gone forever. So that wealth was used by these people. So we need to highlight this philosophy of the Harappans. Tell the world, in fact, you know, this is the philosophy. And then, of course, you know, the Harappans have contributed immensely to the history of the world. You know, they were the first, in fact, you know, to build cities and towns in the world. You know, build a dockyard in the world. And a lot of basic sciences and technologies. So highlight that also. You know, show the world, in fact, you know, what was the contribution made by the Harappans. And thirdly, you know, how relevant it is. What we can learn from the Harappan civilization. And what technique, what, you know, technology that was used by the Harappans can be put to use again. So this is the, you know, these are the things, you know, which need to be highlighted. And this is what we are planning, in fact, at the site of, you know, Rakhigarhi, in fact, in the museum. So then only, you know, people will get attracted. And slowly, you know, people are now realizing the importance of the Harappan civilization. And once we do that, in fact, now I'm sure that, you know, that, you know, a lot of people would like to come and visit. And fortunately, you know, lastly, I would like to tell that, you know, the government of India, they have, particularly this is the initiative of the Prime Minister of the country, that they are developing a huge national maritime heritage complex, you know, near Lothal, very close to the ancient site. And, you know, that is a very important, you know, development coming up in the country. And here in Patna, we would like to showcase the maritime heritage, such a huge maritime we have, right from the maybe Lothal up to Bay of Bengal. And, you know, we can show the trade activities, the monuments, you know, in fact, along the, you know, coastal part, the communities who are living in fact in the coastal part at one place. You know, this is a very important initiative taken by the, you know, Prime Minister of the country. And, you know, the government is realizing the importance of the developing of the, you know, the cultural heritage in the country. And I'm sure that, you know, we can generate so much revenue from this, from the tourism industry, that it will benefit the country. And that needs to be really, I'm of the opinion that, you know, that we need to market our heritage also properly, so that we generate enough revenue, and that revenue partly used for the maintenance of the site, maintenance of the heritage, protecting of the heritage. So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sorry I've taken a lot of time.